Growing up in Virginia, after weathering the humid, muggy summer, the first crisp fall mornings and richly colored leaves were a welcome reward. I always loved watching for the first red leaf that would float to the ground from the trees in our backyard. And I also delighted when I would see the first formation of birds flying in its organized V, headed south for the winter. I often wondered at the sophistication of these orderly trips. Without maps or controls or nuanced language, how did they decide who would lead at the tip of the V? How did they stay in sync with each other, and how did they know where they were going? You may have seen what seems to be an even more awe-inspiring and mysterious formation, a murmuration of starlings. European starlings are one of the most common species of birds in North America, and you may have been lucky enough at some time to see the sky filled with the vast swirling displays of hundreds or even hundreds of thousands of starlings moving in massive undulating clouds of birds that seem at once random and intelligently formed, a giant and constantly changing Rorschach inkblot of birds. While there is not a singular consensus among scientists regarding why starlings murmurate, it is generally understood to be a move designed to avoid predators, as starlings are more likely to murmurate or to do so with greater intensity when predators are attacking. What has been discovered is how the birds move in such coordination with each other, maintaining proximity in their movements despite the often massive numbers of birds. Studies have found that each starling is particularly aware of the 6 or 7 birds that are its nearest neighbors. And in this way, they're able to maintain connection with and move in coordination with the entire flock. This is called scale-free behavioral correlation, in which the movement of a single bird both affects and is affected by the entire flock, no matter its size. By each individual tuning into those around them, starlings move, providing them with protection, enabling them to migrate, allowing them to reach their destination together. And the result is beautiful. Over a landscape not of mountains and fields, land and water, but a societal topography in which rugged individualism reigns and our focus very often rests on small screens in our hands rather than the human beings right in front of us, we're faced with a choice. Do we strive to migrate alone, self-sufficiently pointed south? Or do we join the murmuration in which every individual is equally important no matter the size of the group, in which we are attuned to those around us and deeply connected to one another, in which we can find comfort and protection, and through which we can move forward together, and through which we can create beauty. Vayikra Rabba is the classical compilation of parables and commentaries on the book of Leviticus, and in it we find a story taught by Rabbi Shimon bar Yochai. The story goes that people were on a ship in the middle of an ocean. Suddenly, one person on the ship took up a hand drill and began drilling beneath his own seat. Others around him noticed and were alarmed, exclaiming, "What are you doing there, sitting there and doing?" And he replied, "What do you care? Don't you see I'm only drilling under my own seat?" And they said to him, "But the water will rise and flood all of us on this ship." It takes no more than opening our eyes and looking around this world of ours to see that we're traveling in choppy water, to say the least. From violence to anti-Semitism and other forms of prejudice, from truths being twisted into inflammatory sound bites, to our avoidance of hearing any opinion that differs from our own, from devastating earthquakes to damaging hurricanes, from gridlock in our legislatures to battles on our school boards, we are drilling under our own seats too often blind to the fact that we're all in the same boat and we're taking on water. In the United States, the parlance used around how we operate in our relationships in society is that of rights. What rights does each person have? Is someone infringing on my rights? How do we navigate when one person's rights come into conflict with each other? Judaism's perspective stands in stark contrast to this, using the language of obligation. Halakha, Jewish law, is formulated around our obligations. What are our obligations to others, to community, to the world, to God, and to ourselves? In Judaism, the more powerful you are, the more obligated you are. And the more obligated you are, the more powerful you are. Jewish law acknowledges that at the core, we are all connected, and it's all about relationships, whether to those close to us, to the broader community or society. And therefore, our actions, large and small, impact others, whether in relationships, in family, in community, or beyond. There is a maxim in our tradition: all Israel is responsible for one another. This speaks to our sense of shared connection and responsibility to other Jewish folks, whether they're just around the corner or on the other side of the world. This undergirds our support for Israel. This is core to the mission of organizations like Hayas, which was founded as Hebrew Immigrant Aid Society to help aid Jewish refugees fleeing persecution, and whose mission has expanded to help refugees of all religions and ethnicities worldwide. Interestingly, all Israel is responsible for one another is found in our texts written in two different ways, and they're similar, but they contain important differences. The key difference relates to the root of the core word arevim, responsible, as well as to another small but important word in the phrase. In the Talmud, Rabbi Shimon teaches, Kol Yisrael arevim ze la ze. All Israel is responsible for or to the other. Rabbi Shimon reads the word arevim from the root to guarantee, as one would for a loan. So a person is responsible for another individual, each as individual members of the klal, the whole, like the guarantor of a loan. You would be on the hook for paying the loan back if the borrower shirks her duty. The more meaningful and powerful teaching is that of Rabbi Yehuda, who teaches that the phrasing would accurately be Kol Yisrael arevim ze baze. All Israel is responsible one in another, this one in that one, that we are part of an interconnected whole, deeply intertwined with each other. Rabbi Yehuda understands the word arevim to be from the Hebrew root, meaning to mix up and fuse together into a new entity, like the Hebrew word ta'arovet, mixture. The classic commentator Alchish, commenting on a verse in Deuteronomy, taught, all Israel is one. The body of Israel is composed of a collection of limbs and organs, individual people, with one soul, neshama, that keeps the body alive, each individual considered as one limb of the complete body. We are deeply interconnected. Our lives, our journeys are woven together. We need each other. The sage Hillel taught in Pirkei Avot, Al tifrosh min hatzibur, do not separate yourself from community. In the ancient world, being separated from community was dangerous. You lacked physical protection, livelihood, food, perhaps shelter. In today's world, the effects may be less immediate or visible, but living in our separate bubbles can have deep and damaging impacts as well. When we lack meaningful relationships, mental health and physical health suffer. You are likely familiar with the psychologist Abraham Maslow's concept of the hierarchy of needs, in which physiological needs like water and food are their foundation, with safety and security next. But as soon as those basic needs are met, the very next level that Maslow identifies as being necessary is belonging, being accepted and loved, being part of a social group. My colleague Melanie Aaron notes, "We live today in a time of intense individualism. Not only do we bowl alone, but we listen to our own playlist of music and listen to our own individualized digital news feeds. This intense individualism can lead us to forget we are part of a larger community. We are parts of one body, connected whether or not we open our eyes to that fact. And I want to name that it can feel uncomfortable. It goes against our individualistic societal norms to look around the room, consider our community, and acknowledge that we need each other. But that is just what Judaism calls on us to recognize. Rabbi Shai Held teaches, religion is about many things. One of them is to teach us that we must surrender the illusion of self-sufficiency because we are human and therefore embodied and fragile. The question ultimately is not whether we will be dependent, but on whom. The Torah is a story about leaving destructive dependency to Pharaoh in Egypt and discovering life-affirming dependency on each other as a radical alternative. Dependency is an irreducible part of the human condition and should be embraced as such. There is courage and dignity in learning to say, I need you. I speak so frequently to people who are longing for connection. They want to find kindred spirits. They are longing for a close friend to share joys or sorrows with. They want to find a group of people with shared values who can join together and do good, who can be a port in the storm. But making new connections can feel hard. We're out of practice. We disappear into ourselves, into our Instagram feeds, into our separate homes, when what we most need is each other, when what we most need is right here in this room. In these last 15 months since I joined our Temple Chai community, I have seen the power of community in which people show up, connecting with each other, supporting each other, and uplifting people they know and people they do not yet know. This is part of who we are. This is woven into the fabric of our congregation. I see members attending Shiva Minyans even when they've not met the grieving person or family, demonstrating to the mourners that they are not alone in their grief. I see a teenage madricha, religious school teaching aide, put her arm around another teenage madricha going through a tough time, taking a quiet moment to say, I'm so glad you're here today. You've got this. I see friendships forged at the women's retreat that have lasted for decades, and others that bonded just this year sitting and laughing together. I see people enjoying each other's company, joking while making burritos to fill community fridges. I see the volunteer with our Shalom Center calling and visiting someone who's isolated and can't drive themselves, and that connection is a lifeline to the person being visited, and deeply meaningful to the volunteer. And on and on. We know the power of connecting with each other in community. But even so, not all of us are tapped into that yet, or not fully. Not all of us are connected yet. I'm going to do something now that my resident introvert, my husband, has advised me against doing. Introverts, I apologize to you in advance. Alchet shechatati. I promise I'll repent on Yom Kippur. What I want you to do is to look around this room. Yes, actually, look around the room at this time. If you're online, post in the comments, say, Hineni, here I am. Here present, look around the room. Meet someone else's eyes, or a couple people's eyes. Someone in this room, this is a fascinating social experiment, actually. Thank you to those looking around. Others, I know you're doing it in your hearts. Someone in this room, someone perhaps in the same row as you, could be your next dear friend, and you don't know it yet. And their friendship can bring joy and meaning to your life. Someone a couple rows in front of you is having a really tough time dealing with sorrow, and you can be present for them. Someone in the row behind you needs to talk about a tough challenge they're having. Or perhaps someone in that row may be just the person who can support you in a difficult moment you are having right now, or God forbid is around the corner. Someone across the room can be as dear to you as family, and together you can laugh and cry and celebrate together. Now, the skeptics among us may be thinking, I have good friends. I feel good in community. I don't feel like I need new ones. Okay. But I know that you are just the person whose presence will make a difference for someone in this room. And you never know. In the process, you may find that you truly need that person in return. And if you think I'm not speaking to you, let me be clear. I mean you. Especially you. I need you. We need you, and we need each other. And to take it one step further, this community, the active Jewish community as a whole, yes, but our Temple Chai community needs you. If you're currently a Temple Chai member, you're joining as a guest, if you're Jewish, Jewish adjacent, searching or seeking, religious and or cultural, all in or thoroughly skeptical, our community needs you. Not only are we interconnected limbs and organs of a single body, but every single person in this room and in our virtual room has something essential to bring to our community to make it the most welcoming, passionate, spiritual, learning, creative, tikkun olam focused, powerfully present it can be. Now, do we need our whole community to join together to support us in creating our new physical space, our new home? Absolutely. And just as importantly, perhaps even more importantly, every single person in this room has an essential role to play as we join together in creating the next chapter in the life of our community. And we cannot do it without every single one of you. Our Temple Chai community needs you. If you want to work for justice and to help those in need, our social action team needs your vision and action. If you like the idea of connecting with others through a shared interest, there's a Chai Connect circle for you. If you want to find a meaningful way to support others without committing to specific weekly hours, you can join our team supporting Shiva Minions. We need more people on that team. If you are a younger adult who wants Jewish friends in your life phase, we need you in tribe. As Rabbi Zalman Schachter Shlomi taught, the only way to get it together is together. The story is told of a small village hundreds of years ago in which a Jewish nobleman wanted to leave a meaningful legacy for the people of his town. And after much thought, he decided that he himself would build a synagogue. See, David, I'm planting seeds right here. The nobleman acquired the land and had the plans drawn up, and they began to build. Now, this nobleman knew that aphorism about two Jews and three opinions, and so for simplicity's sake, he decided not to allow anyone to see the plans or the building itself until it was finished. Finally, when it was complete, the entire town was invited to enter the building to dedicate their new sacred space. Everyone came in, oohing and aahing at the beautiful woodwork, the ark, the soaring ceilings, the comfortable chairs. As they were enjoying the new space, the evening began to fall, the sun began to set, and the room grew dim. And there was some murmuring and rumbling of the concern that started. Finally, a young girl piped up, "Where are the lamps? How will anyone see each other once the sun goes down?" The nobleman smiled, and from a large case, he took lamps. And he went around to every family, every resident of the town, handing each one a lamp. He pointed to the brackets that were affixed to the walls for each lamp. And he said, "Each of you has a lamp, and there's one bracket for every lamp. When you come into the synagogue, bring your lamp and place it in the bracket. Every time you are not here," he said, "a part of the synagogue will remain dark. No matter how beautiful the space, you have to remember that it is you who provide the light for our community. In our new home, don't worry, we won't forget the light fixtures. Yet the lesson remains true. We need you. We need the lamps of your spirit and your presence. Without you, our community is not complete and our light would be diminished. We can provide the space and the structure, but you are the ones who will fill our new sanctuary, our new home, with light." The poet Adrian Rich asked, "Where are we moored? What are the bindings?" Our community is one body, individual souls bound together, finding grounding in relationship, exponentially greater in its wholeness than the sum of its parts. In this new year of 5,784, I call on each of us to join the murmuration. Like starlings on the backdrop of the sky, our formation shifts and moves, changing to adapt to the needs of the moments and to build for the future. Let us tune in to those around us, reaching out in connection and in relationship. Let us commit to finding new ways to show up for each other in community and for our community. In our murmuration, we will find protection and comfort. We will find joy lifting us up as the air flowing beneath our wings. In this way, we will move forward together. Kein yehi ratzon, may this be God's will. Amen.
Sorry. Let us sing this song for the turning of the world, that we may turn as one. With every voice, with every song, we will move this world along, and our lives will feel the echo of our turning. With every voice, with every song, we will move this world along. With every voice, with every song, we will move this world along, and our lives will feel the echo of our turning. Let us sing this song for the healing of the world, that we may heal as one. With every voice, with every song, we will move this world along, and our lives will feel the echo of our healing. With every voice, with every voice, song, we will move this world along. With every voice, with every song, we will move this world along, and our lives will feel the echo of our healing. Let us sing this song for the praying of the world, that we may pray as one. With every voice, with every song, we will move this world along, and our lives will feel the echo of our praying. With every voice, with every song. We will move this world along. With every voice, with every song, we will move this world along. And our lives will feel the echo of our praying. Let us sing this song. Song, we will move this world along, and our lives will feel the echo of our building. With every voice, with every song, we will move this world along. With every voice, with every song, we will world along, and our lives will feel the echo of our building, and our lives will feel the echo of our praying, and our lives will feel the echo of our healing, and our lives will feel the echo of our turn.
Singing.